Diversity, the wider vision on BCTV is supported by Berks Community Action Program.
Welcome to Diversity, the Wider Vision. Tonight, we're going to celebrate Women's History Month. Although you're watching this on Monday, March 13th, we're actually taping this on Tuesday, February 14th. We're going to have five guests, and one of our guests, Dow Fox, is running a restaurant, Thai Cuisine, and this is a big night for them, Valentine's Day, so she'll be on at 10 minutes to 8, actually 10 minutes to 9, for your time here in March. But the other guests include Charlise Bell, who is a psychotherapist. Charlise, thank you for coming on with us tonight. I'm giving the names in alphabetical order. The next person that we expected to come on is Rebecca Reppert. She's not here yet, but when she comes on, we'll introduce you to her also. The next person I want you to meet is Francine Scoboria, who is the communications coordinator for Safe Berks. We are expecting another lady, a Dominican lady named Saoni Segura. When she comes on, we'll introduce her. But we're going to get started with people who are here.
She's here.
Yeah. Who's here? Is that Saoni?
Yep, I'm here.
Thank you very much. Buenas noches.
Buenas noches.
Okay. Thank you for coming on. She's an outreach coordinator. She's also on the mayor's youth commission. So thank you for joining us tonight. We're excited about having a diverse background of clients. We have a Latina, we have an Asian coming on later, we have a Caucasian, we have an African American. We're going to start out with Charlise Bell, who was a psychotherapist. Charlise, thanks for coming on.
Thank you for having me.
So tell us about psychotherapy. How long have you been doing that?
So I graduated with my master's in clinical mental health in 2019 from Kutztown. So I'd say about 4 years.
And I'm so happy that psychotherapists, psychiatrists, psychologists are getting their due now. Unfortunately, the reason why that's happened is because COVID set us back. So it's made therapy much more important now. Do you work with young people for the most part? Are you working with children, young people?
Yes, I work primarily with the young people ages 12 to 18.
And I guess you have to help them with their self-esteem, help them feel good about themselves, help them overcome challenges, I guess you would say, wouldn't you?
Absolutely. A lot of the young people who come in, they don't have a voice. They're not being heard. And they're also coming in hurting because of like the messages they received from maybe parents or other adults. They come in with abandonment issues, rejection, fear, loss. So just helping them work through those things and then reintegrating them back into their community.
So actually they work with you, they then go back to their communities and hopefully they're better and they can handle things better because you kind of prepare them for what they've gone through.
Yep.
Do you ever work with them in groups so that they can sort of help each other out because and they share their experiences? Has that ever happened?
Yeah, we do our clinical groups, and we do that 3 times a week for about an hour, where they're able to share with one another and relate to each other and build one another up, yes.
If there's a young person watching tonight who wants to be a psychotherapist, tell us about the kind of background. What do they do? What do they get their degrees in?
So if you wanted to be a psychotherapist, you can go to school for a bachelor's in social work. You can go to school for psychology, and then you would continue on and go for your master's in clinical mental health. You can go for marriage counseling. You can go for family counseling. And then once you get your master's, you can also become licensed and have your own practice. And you can also move on and get your doctorates. And that's when you get into the psychologists and psychiatrists.
One of the things some people don't know in our audience is that we have psychiatrists who are physicians who specialize in mental health And we have clinical psychologists who specialize in mental health also, but they have different roles. It's only the psychiatrist who can prescribe medicine. But most psychotherapists know what medicines make a difference in terms of behavior, just that they don't prescribe, but they can recommend to a person to a psychiatrist who can, I guess, prescribe those kinds of things.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Let me ask you, we've heard a lot about bulimia and anorexia. Is that something that happens only to women? Does it happen? You have any cases of men who have that also?
Yeah, there's cases of men who have those issues as well. I mean, they're not as open as the women to speaking on them, but they are out there, yes.
One of the things that I think is so important, I'm taking this from the perspective of a male, is that oftentimes we don't want to own up to our shortcomings. We think it's not cool to be weak. And I think that you probably can help us understand that it's okay to share your feelings and your shortcomings and learn to grow from them. I think sometimes we become too defensive about owning up to shortcomings. And I think that one of the things I've had to deal with is crying in public. And I guess crying can be therapeutic, but somehow a part of me says, I don't want them to see me cry, which can be counterproductive.
Yeah, I mean, a lot of the males, I work with the male adolescents, and they come in with the anger and the rage because the message they received was, you can't cry. If you cry, you're a punk. If you cry, that means you're a sissy. So rather than crying and being vulnerable, they tend to become aggressive. And that's the main reason, one of the biggest presenting issues we have with our clients.
So what you're really telling me is that if we keep those feelings pent up, we make matters worse.
Oh, yeah. Bottling emotions, you're bound to explode. And that's what happens. We bottle them up and then they explode. Yeah.
Well, I'm hoping that with this new emphasis and credibility given to psychotherapists and psychiatrists and psychologists and counselors and social workers, maybe more of us will express our feelings and be open about them, and perhaps we will have a healthier community.
Yeah.
Hopefully. Do you find more women or more men as psychotherapists? Do you think it's an equal balance of those who are in the field? What have you noticed?
Well, I'm in the residential, so I'm mostly working with the children. We do have a girls' unit. And I must say the girls they're more vulnerable and more open to speaking about some of those issues. The boys, they have an issue with being able to be vulnerable and to communicate what it is that is happening. But I, you know, it's an equal balance, but I'm not working with adults.
So. Well, I'm hoping that more of us, present company included, like me, can learn to really get those feelings out there and deal with them and grow from them, I guess you could say, and grow from them. Well, I'm so happy what you're doing, that you're making life better for a lot of young people, that they'll be better and stronger adults because they have a chance to interact with you and get some help. Has Rebecca arrived yet? Is she here yet? She hasn't, so I'm going to go.
She's here. Yes.
There she is. Great. Yes. How are you? Thanks for coming.
Yes, thank you.
This is Rebecca Reppert. She has Native American blood, and she's done a lot of work out west with Native Americans. Now, one thing I want to say before I ask her to comment on some of her experiences is the fact that so many of us don't know that when Christopher Columbus set out to the New World, he really was trying to find Asia. And so when he arrived in the Caribbean in 1492, he thought he was in the Far East. And so he thought that the indigenous people he saw, they were Indians. And so he made the classic mistake, and we still call many people in indigenous America as Indians, although we have Indians in the East who are soon going to be the largest population in the world. And that's a big difference. And of course, that's because Columbus thought when he came here that he was, these people were Indian. They weren't. Many people call them Native Americans today, but they are our indigenous group. Rebecca, you have worked out west on reservations, haven't you?
I spent 18 years teaching English on the Navajo reservation, yes.
And what are some things about their growth, their development that we aren't aware of, that because we've been kind of like sheltered from their experiences? What have you noticed, or should you share with us that we don't really know about their experiences, their culture, that just are not known by most Americans.
I will tell you something. You asked me earlier about the position of women, and I know there's just a short time. I'm going to tell you something amazing. The position of women, especially in Navajo cultures, we would call it perhaps higher. They would describe it as co-equal. But I read a fascinating article the other day on, and I'll tell you the name of it in case you want to look it up, how Native American women inspired the women's rights movement. And that's actually referring to Iroquois specifically, which is another Native culture where the women have positions of authority and political power and political control. This would be the one thing I think that would be very surprising to most people. I learned so much from Native Americans. I say maybe I wasn't teaching them, maybe they were teaching me. But specific to that question, I want to point out this. The woman suffragist called Matilda Gage back in the 1800s was so disgusted with the suffragette movement, she quit it because they weren't making any progress. And she and Elizabeth Cady Stanton got together and they started, they lived near the Iroquois, the Confederacy, and they learned a lot from the people nearby. So this lady was writing articles describing their culture and so forth. And they were so impressed, the natives were so impressed with her, they adopted her into the Wolf Clan of their tribe. But anyway, the thing about Navajos is they have a very big coming of age ceremony for girls when they turn of age, puberty ceremony. Women are in charge of the home, the animal herding, weaving, traditional medicine and ceremonies. So they have a lot of responsibilities. And then translating that into today's culture, they do the traditional things I mentioned, plus having a regular 9-to-5 job. In Navajo culture, the woman has the final say-so. She is the head of the clan and of the family. So everyone defers to the woman's authority.
So they really are equals, and men and women. There's not the rejection of women that we see in some other places.
Excuse me. Well, as they say, not only equal, but in some, you might say a little more than equal. They also have female goddesses. Changing woman is almost like a concept of a divinity. Spider woman taught them how to weave. Changing woman created the whole universe, and it's a very complex figure. But I mean, woman, in other words, the deity is a female, not a male figure in that situation. There are male gods, but it's very interesting to me that they have extremely important female figures in the Navajo culture and also a couple of others as well.
Did you say Spider Woman?
Yes, that's her name, because there's something called Spider Rock, which is a long, tall rock formation at the bottom of Canyon de Chelly, very tall. And the Spider Woman figure was supposed to have lived up there and woven a strand of thread that would go across the canyon. Of course, that's mythology, but it plays an important role in their concept of who they are as people. So the spider, you don't kill a spider in your house. Spiders are sacred, and Spider Woman is the one that taught the Navajos how to weave, according to their legend.
I must admit that I tend to have a favoritism of spiders also. I don't kill spiders in my house also, because I know spiders will kill the flies and mosquitoes if they can catch them in their webs. Most people are so afraid of them, and they get killed, I think, unfortunately. Now, you mentioned the Navajos. Are they, out for the most part, out west?
Oh, yes. Traditionally, now they're all over the world, thanks to the military. You've got Navajos in the military. So you find Navajos everywhere. But traditionally, they're mostly in Arizona and New Mexico and a little bit in Utah, spread out over 3 states. Yeah.
Now, you mentioned Iroquois. Are they in the Midwest? Are they?
No. Iroquois is New York State.
New York State.
Haudenosaunee is their name. They live in New York State. Yes, sir. Okay. Yes. Up for New York State.
It's interesting that Pennsylvania doesn't have any reservations. One of the few states that don't.
Let me think about that. I don't think there are.
No, we don't have
because the tribes that were here for a while were not recognized, the smaller groups, and the Delaware actually are located, you know, they're sort of south of here. So no, there isn't exactly, no.
One of the great tragedies that occurred in 1830 was something called the Trail of Tears.
Yes.
Uh-huh. Which is unfortunate because there were lots of Indians in the Southeast who were forced to move out to Oklahoma. And for many years, Oklahoma was that state with the largest amount of Native Americans. That's not true anymore, but for many years it was. And of course, the other thing I found interesting is that there have been some Native Americans who have had casinos on their property.
Mm-hmm.
Did you see any in New Mexico or Arizona? Did you see any out there? Were there any?
Oh yeah, they did put up one in the northern near the Four Corners. At first, the tribal council was against it. They didn't want gambling on their reservations, so you'd have to go across the border to Colorado to the Ute casino to gamble up there. But then they decided to put one up. I think it's called Northern Edge or some name like that. Anyway, there is one right there in the Farmington, New Mexico. Years, but they finally did agree to allow gambling on their reservation. Now, the smaller tribes, especially the ones in the East and California, before that long ago, you know, they wanted to allow casinos for income. But you see, Navajos had the oil and coal rights. They had other sources of revenue, and they didn't need to get into that right away. But some of the other tribes really needed the money, and so they opened up these casinos. Yeah, they're a huge source of revenue, especially in the New York area.
Now, we like to think that the American culture is individualistic, and that some of the other cultures of people of color are collectivistic. Did you see a lot of that amongst Native Americans where the group was more important than the individual? Did you see that also?
Yes, that something called kin, which means, you know, kinship in a very broad sense. Yes, you were, especially the head of household, you know, you're supposed to take care of your whole entire family, even the ones who are alcoholic or unemployed or in other ways. They might be thrown out of their families if they were in mainstream society, but in the native cultures, you take care of everybody, especially if you're the woman. It's your job to take care of everybody. But the idea is, yeah, collective, what's best for the group or the community. It's a little hard to summarize this in 3 seconds or less, but yeah, that's sort of broadly speaking the idea. But you know, people go to college, they go to school, they go out to their job, and they, of course, you know, they're like regular Americans, but obviously traditionally there were these little groups that were scattered all over the Southwest, and you did this for survival. You know, it was more a survival thing. So
now you must have discovered some foods that were much more popular amongst Native Americans than amongst traditional Americans. Did you see that out the West? Were any foods that I always thought that corn was introduced to us by? But there are any other foods that you think are much more popular amongst Native Americans?
A lot of people would grow corn. And the very first job I had was a place called Many Farms, or Dakalani, which literally means many farms, and the farms were cornfields. So everybody had a cornfield. But anyway, the fun food that they're known for out West is fry bread, which is a deep fried disc of dough. And that came about during the long walk as a sort of hurry up kind of food to make. But that's associated with Indian people. It's not really their traditional food, but it's something that popular culture has, you know, fry bread is supposed to be Indian. But yes, the one that Navajos made that was unusual and really tasty, I thought, was kneel down bread, which is mashed up corn kernels stuffed into a corn husk and then steamed. It's really good. And then no sugar, no salt, there's nothing in there. And it's really quite good. So driving down the highway, you'd see these vendors in the late summer and early fall when the corn harvest was done selling these things called kneel down bread in the husk, you know, in coolers, you know, by the side of the road, so you could get that. Another thing that, of course, Navajos would eat is mutton stew. Some people thought it was a little greasy. I liked it. It had corn and maybe a little bit of onions or something in it. Mutton stew with fry bread would be a typical.
Now, what is mutton stew? Is that rabbit? What is mutton stew?
Mutton. Mutton is sheep.
Okay. Wow.
Sheep. Yeah, they would eat a lot of sheep. So that's a little different. And then tradition, again, going back in time, historically, they would have been eating wild game. You know, they wouldn't. Mutton is since the arrival of the Spaniards who brought the sheep. But traditionally, they would have hunted wild game and so forth. But I mean, Navajos are associated with sheep eating. The Plains Indians are associated with, of course, buffalo meat and making pemmican and stuff like that. But where I was, it was the sheep. Yeah.
Now, you were teaching English, is that correct?
Yes.
You were there.
Yes.
Now, were there lots of people there who spoke other languages? Was there another, for example, the Navajo?
Well, it varied, not other languages. Some communities were, luckily, I was in one that was pretty traditional where you had kids from homes where they still spoke Diné or Navajo. But there was no Spanish, really, and there was no other, you didn't hear other languages. They either were fully bilingual or they spoke a little bit of Navajo and and some English. but I was supposed to, yeah, I was teaching English. And then they would learn maybe some Spanish in high school or something, but it wasn't around, not where I live.
So most of the students who taught English also spoke Navajo. They spoke that also?
Well, some did. Some did. Again, depending on the community, some communities are pretty anglicized and actually they're afraid of losing their language because not that many of the younger kids would speak it. Only the older generation would be speaking it. So depending where you were, there would be more native speakers. Now, again, they are aware of this and they are teaching it in the lower grades so that they want their own generations to be fully bilingual. That's their goal, is to not lose their language.
So is the Navajo language written? Is it a written language? Is it something you can put?
Someone did write it. Yeah, you can study it as a written language. It, of course, was oral and it's very difficult. It's a non-Western language. It's very complex. It's not easy to learn it. But you can, it is written down. They have the hymn books and Bible translated into Navajo. So you can learn it if you want to, sure.
Did you find that most of your students were bilingual? Did did most of them speak it or?
I'm trying to consider how to answer that. I would say for what you're asking me, yes, they would certainly understand spoken Navajo. And some very much at a high level and some just enough to get by. Most of the teachers that were not Navajo didn't understand a whole lot, but a few would study it and take the time to learn it. I never learned much.
I mentioned that because I'm a former foreign language teacher. And my experience has been that when I don't see the language written, I just deal with the sounds. I think I begin to pronounce it better. Mm-hmm. But when I try to look at the written language, I sometimes don't pronounce the foreign language as well. I found that there were many situations where I was only heard it, and I mimic what I heard, and I thought I spoke better in those situations than I did when I had written and had the translation and tried to assimilate that way. So I'm always fascinated. You had students who were bilingual and students who spoke the other language also. And I always wondered if that has any way inhibited the ability to learn English.
Well, their culture teaches them to listen very carefully, and you learn by listening and imitating your elders. And so they would be used to listening and learning that way. They would be accustomed to that. That's how Native kids learn. And I found that on the whole, they're better listeners than the average American kids that are out there. You tell them something once and they get it. You don't have to keep going over it. So, I mean, they're used to following things orally. But as to your point, some learners are more visual and some are more auditory. That's just people, humans, anywhere. And so you have a preferred modality that's yours. But as a general rule, you would learn, again, but simply by immersion, by being around other people in the community who would always speak it. That's how you pick it up.
I'm fascinated with the fact that there are many different tribes, many different languages. And I always wondered about, you know, interaction between different tribes. So did you see any of that? Any interaction, for example, let's say between, for example, what different tribes did you see in New Mexico and Arizona? Was there
well, and I can tell you, just let me, sorry, I'm a little tired. In Arizona, you had Hopis and other Pueblo peoples, and New Mexico more. Let me rephrase that. New Mexico had all the Southern and Northern Pueblo Indians around Albuquerque and Santa Fe area. That's where you have the Puebloan Indians, and there's a number of them. I won't list them all. And then out towards Arizona, you had the Hopis. And then in Southern New Mexico, you have Apaches. And then in Northern New Mexico, you have a different band of Apaches. And then towards the border, you have other tribes that are towards the border near the Sonoran Desert area. So, oh boy. Where I lived in Northern New Mexico and Northern Arizona. So I was also near Colorado and Utah. So the Ute tribe was up there. You asked, do they ever get together? Yes, for powwows. That was a big time for people to get together. Albuquerque has a huge and very colorful and amazing spectacle called the Intertribal in Albuquerque, where a lot of tribes from all over the nation get together and perform and dance and everything, and the princesses parade and all that. But as far as day-to-day, what would you see? Who would you run into? When I taught in Tuba City, Arizona, it was called the Checkerboard Area. So it was divided between Hopis and Navajos only. That's all in that area. That would be the northwest part of the state. And then towards Farmington, there was only Navajos that way. And then if you keep going more west from Farmington, now you're getting closer to Colorado, and I taught Apaches up there. Then you have Jicarilla Apache and Mescalero Apache are two of the bands. So, I mean, day to day, you would mostly just see one tribe, and that was Navajos. They're the most numerous. But people intermarried, and then they also traveled, of course, like anybody else. They would travel between areas. So it would be possible to see any of those tribes that I just mentioned and have them in class. But as far as the hundreds and hundreds of, you know, Midwestern and Eastern tribes, no, of course not. We're talking only of people who lived in the region. That's all. So.
Well, it sounds like you had a wonderful experience out there. Really great interactions and...
It was amazing. It was like being in another world. I'm looking forward to going back. I think I'll be going back this year again. Very interesting time.
And of course, you saw another culture and probably saw some values that you really appreciated that we don't have, that you saw amongst the Native Americans that we probably could use. Well, thanks for sharing with us your experiences. I think that so too often we don't understand their culture, their practices, and I think in many ways we robbed them. We in some cases we actually ran them off of their land, which is so unfortunate.
Well, thanks again. And I just encourage everyone sometime go out and visit. There's great vacation spots there. A lot of these places are near national parks. They make great, great family trips. And if you want to just read a little bit, you can always read books or read some articles online and learn some more for yourself. But there's nothing like being there. It's wide open country. It's beautiful country. And I do look forward to returning. I do. It was quite the experience. Thanks
again. Any books you want to recommend to us?
Oh, not right now. No. Okay.
All right. Thank you. Again, thanks so much for coming on and sharing with us.
Thank you, Dr. Amprey.
I want to go to Saoni Segura, who is Dominican, and and you're bilingual also, aren't you?
Yes, I am.
That is great. Which language was English first or was Spanish first?
Spanish. Yes, I grew up in DR.
Okay. Well, now I guess you probably enjoy mango. Is that one of your favorite dishes?
Yeah, I would say so.
Now, you're an outreach coordinator now.
Correct.
What kind of things does that require you to do?
So I coordinate the volunteer efforts at my nonprofit. I attend community events, and I also help out with social media and marketing materials and like writing newsletters.
And you're a graduate of Penn State Berks.
Yes, correct.
So what did you major in?
I majored in global studies with a minor in business.
And you're also on the mayor's youth commission, which is that must be a good experience also.
Yep. I am the vice chair of the youth commission. It's nice. Yeah.
Now, most of the young people on that commission are Hispanic. Is that correct?
Yes, most of them are Hispanics. Correct.
So you have Boricua, Dominicanos. You have any other groups other than the Americanos también?
Right now, we have Dominicans, Puerto Ricans, and Mexican.
Uh-huh. Now, when you communicate with them, do you communicate in English or in Spanish, or both?
Well, the meetings are usually run in English, but, like, uh-huh. Sometimes, like, we would, like, say a couple of words and phrases in Spanish, but for the most part, it's in English, yeah.
Well, I think the fact that you're bilingual is really a blessing. Can you think of any experiences you've had professionally where being bilingual was an advantage or a tremendous help?
Oh, yes. So as a community outreach coordinator, we get like clients coming to our offices, and like sometimes we don't have like more Spanish or Spanish speaking like my coworkers, like they're not there or they're busy helping somebody out. So I would have to like step in and help them. And I've also been to like, I've helped out with like bail hearings. So like I would go and like I would like translate the papers for like the people that are getting help getting bail, so they can better understand what they're doing and what they're signing.
So you can both speak and read the language very well, which is a blessing.
Yes, correct.
Did you take a lot of Spanish courses here in the country growing up, or?
No, I just like I said, I grew up in DR, so I went to school in DR up until like fifth grade. And mom is a teacher, my uncle's a teacher, so they've indoctrinated me in Spanish, and then I always go back home almost every year, so I'm constantly speaking the language.
Oh, it's so good you can get both cultures together. I had a chance to visit San Pedro de Macorís.
Oh, I love that.
And being a big baseball fan, I really enjoyed the fact that there were so many people there who played baseball, and you probably know that there are more Dominican baseball players than any other in the United States, and most of them are from San Pedro de Macorís. But I also got a chance to visit Puerto Plata and Santo Domingo. Mm-hmm. And of course, the country is, what part of the Republic of Dominicana do you visit when you go there?
Well, I'm from the south, so I'm from Asua. We're kind of near the border to Haiti. So I'm not really from the city, I'm more from like a rural area.
Uh-huh. Mm-hmm. One of the things I find fascinating is that the Dominican Republic, when it got its independence, it didn't get it from Spain, it got it from Haiti. So it's fascinating. Most people don't know that the island has two different languages there because the Haitians speak French and Creole, And of course, Dominicans speak Spanish. Have you had a chance to study any French?
Well, in DR, growing up in school, they actually make you take French and English. So yeah, but like I never really got into like the French language. I just focused more like the English, and it's like more like commercial, and then I ended up moving here, so.
Well, I'm fascinated that you have no accent. So you really have mastered English. You're kind of laughing. You think you have an accent?
I mean, yes, I think so.
I can't pick it up. but to that extent, they say that if you study the languages before you're 10, you don't have an accent in either language. So I think maybe coming here, you know, around 10 or 11 may have been a real blessing for you in that regard. But yeah. I think that working on the Mayor's Youth Commission is really a blessing for you. And also being outreach coordinator is also a blessing. I'm fascinated because our mayor is Puerto Rican, but his, I'm not sure whether his main coordinator is Puerto Rican or Dominican, but I think having the two cultures come together. But I do know that our newly elected state representative is Dominican.
Yes,
she is Dominican. Her husband is Puerto Rican, and I think she's still going to keep the restaurant. So it's one of people's favorite eating places. That's always a popularity. It looks like Dow is here.
Yes.
Early. Before you go, Saoni, tell us some of the things that you guys talk about in the Youth Commission. What do you guys plan? I know you did a Halloween activity, didn't you?
Yes, the Halloween on Penn. So the Halloween on Penn started 2 years ago. It was actually started by one of our youth commissioners, Brandon Hernandez. He was kind of the one that came up with the idea and got the ball rolling, and then started like reaching out to like other organizations to partake in it. But right now we are constantly collaborating with the village. So we're there almost every Friday night at their Teens Cafe, which is located at City Park. And right now we're trying to create a couple of events for the youth for the summer and for Mental Health Awareness Month in May.
Well, keep up the good work. Thank you for what you're doing. I think that the fact that the mayor has youth, is working with our youth, because all too often us old geezers forget about the needs of youth. We don't always communicate well. So we need people like you who can communicate, keep us in touch with the many changes that are taking place in our society. Let me move on. Thanks again for being here. Muchas gracias.
Thank you.
I want to take a few minutes and talk to Ms. Francine Scoboria, who is the communication coordinator for Safe Berks. Francine, thanks again for coming on. You've been so faithful every year helping us out with our understanding of Safe Berks.
Thank you for inviting us and letting me represent Safe Berks here on the show.
For the people who don't know, what is Safe Berks?
Safe Berks is the local nonprofit organization that provides free services to survivors of domestic violence and sexual assault. Our services are free, they're confidential, and they're available 24 hours a day, 365 days a year. And our services include, we have a shelter, we have counseling, we have legal services, including assistance with requesting a protection from abuse order. We have medical advocacy and community outreach and response, and we have education aimed at preventing violence in general and domestic violence and sexual assault specifically. So I want to just mention our 24-hour hotline in case anybody who would be watching this would want to request our services, which is 844-789-SAFE, which is S-A-F-E or 7233, or anyone can text the words Safe Berks to 20121. And I also just want to mention that as we were chatting about, Joe, we were founded in 1976 as Berks Women in Crisis. And some people still think of us by that name or by BWIC, our old acronym. But other people might not realize that we are the same organization, the exact same organization, same people, same founders, same everything, except that we've continued to grow. We changed our name in 2016 when we had our 40th anniversary. And the reason we changed our name is because we don't just serve women, and domestic violence and sexual assault are not just problems that affect women. They're really problems that affect the human race. And we serve human beings. We serve any human being who is suffering from these crimes, as well as their significant others and families. And also, so our name is also our goal, because we want to build a safe Berks. We do a lot of education. We're in the schools, we're in the colleges, and we're in the community everywhere that we are invited or we can invite ourselves. And so thank you for inviting us. This is the kind of thing we always want to be, just sharing our information, just so that more people would know that we are available 24 hours a day for help, and no one should ever be abused.
It's my understanding that some women need help, but are afraid that if their significant others know that they're getting help, they can suffer more. So I think you can be, they can be confidential, they can be there. And
it's actually true. If you are in an abusive relationship, the absolute most dangerous time is when you attempt to leave. And that is known. And there's many, many tragic stories of people who were killed at the time that they were trying to leave. So this is something that's very serious. And if anyone contacts our hotline or comes to work with our counselors and our legal professionals, any of our trained experts, they can work with the person on safety planning. Safety planning is very important. And we also work with law enforcement many times to try to help someone safely leave their abusive relationship. And of course, if they have children, to safely get the children out too. So this is something to take very seriously. We understand that it is a very, very courageous thing to attempt to leave, because often an abusive person who is abusing someone, it's all rooted in control. The person is feeling they're losing control, then they might become even more violent. So we would ask and hope that people would call the hotline, get in touch with us. We have many, many excellent professionals who are very compassionate and really experts in these fields, and they can help come up with a safety plan. And it's not it's not the best thing to tell the abusive person that you're leaving. It's best to work with some experts and make a safety plan, get to safety, and then take the next steps. And everything is, of course, up to that person. We offer advice, we offer tools that are free, but every single decision is in the hands of the survivor. They are the driver of the bus. We just have tools that we can offer, you know, to help the person, but every decision they make is their decision, of course.
Sometimes other friends or relatives know that person being abused and can't understand why they won't leave, and don't understand how to help them leave. So I think it's very much for us to reach out to you for help, because you have experience, you know how to work, you know what to say and how to plan to leave. And sometimes we just don't know.
Yeah, and I want to mention it makes sense why it is so difficult to leave if a person is threatening to kill someone or kill their children or their pets. You know, those threats are very effective in causing someone to feel completely controlled. And another form of control that is very common is financial abuse. Many abusers will control all the money, even if the other person might be working full time. But often the abuser will control all the resources, all the financial resources. They might even ruin the credit of the person, making it harder. You can imagine how hard it is to become independent if you have no control of any money, even money that you make. So one thing we have at Safe Berks, in addition to everything I mentioned, is we have a financial empowerment course, which is specifically for recovery from financial abuse. And it involves learning everything about your finances, rebuilding your credit. And we have experts in this, and this is all free too. And it's a very effective tool in gaining independence. We also have help with housing advocacy, employment advocacy, childcare advocacy, all of the pieces of an independent life that you need to put together, which is a very complicated thing to do, especially when you're dealing with a constant trauma in your home. So if people wonder why it's hard to leave, just put yourself in the shoes of someone who's being terrorized in their own home. It's really makes sense why it's so hard to leave. But we do know many wonderful success stories and people that successfully are able to leave the abusive relationship, build their own independent, happy, safe life with their children. And many of them come full circle in that they donate to us, they volunteer at Safe Berks. They're people that are helping other survivors. So it's a very full circle situation that there's many, many people who are successfully able to leave an abusive relationship.
One of the most heartwarming situations are those where people were abusers, were able to overcome it, find their success, and then go back and help other people because they've been there. And that there's really some great stories. I'm reading the Stephen A. Smith story right now. This is a guy whose mother worked two jobs to raise six kids. And yet the father would come into the home, never work, but somehow intimidate the mother. And so what you're talking about is brought to life in this book, which is very popular right now. But what you guys do for so many women is wonderful. Please keep up the good work. You are a godsend for our community.
Well, thank you very much on behalf of the whole staff, because I write and share information, but I want to just, you know, kudos to the people working in the Safe House, you know, which is running 24 hours a day. And through COVID-19, we never closed down. We stayed open 24 hours a day through the whole pandemic. So also want to congratulate the leadership of Safe Berks that was able to maintain that through COVID. But yeah, thank you for letting us share information, because we want people to know we're here.
The fact that you're able to stay open during COVID is phenomenal. We really appreciate the great things you guys have done. Thank you very much. Last but not least, I want to bring on Dow Fox. Dow Fox is the proprietor of Thai Cuisine. Dow, thanks for coming on the business day of the year. Thanks for taking time out of your very important day. As I told the audience, even though we're televised on the 13th of March, this is being taped on Valentine's Day. And this is a big day for Dow, but she's taking the last 2 minutes to come and talk to us. Dow, thanks for coming.
Thank you, Jill, for having me. Yes, it's a full house tonight, really busy. Happy Valentine's Day.
Go ahead. And thanks for taking the time to come. Now, you were born in Thailand, is that correct?
Yes, I am. I came from Thailand in 1981 to go to school, to study. And I met my husband, and I started opening the restaurant. We moved to Reading. We started a little corner shop at 8th Street, 8th and Walnut. 1991, and we're still doing this 33 years later.
Please tell us your address and phone number of Thai cuisine.
We have Thai. When we first moved here, nobody knew what Thai food is all about. So Thai food, Thai cuisine, it's more like pretty much stir fry. We use a lot of lemongrass, basil, chili pepper, and curry paste. So everything, people think it's spicy, but it's not spicy, but it's really flavorful. And we make it the way you want it, mild, spicy, medium, whichever, come with a lot of vegetable. We are located at 502 Eisenbrown Street behind Boscow's North on 5th Street. We open only from 5 until 8, Tuesday to Saturday. And you also can bring your own bottle of wine or whatever you want.
Now, would you say that Thai cuisine is different from Japanese and Chinese cuisine? Big difference?
Absolutely. Japanese restaurant or Japanese food is more like, you know, like sushi, raw fish and all that. Mine is cooked. Pretty much stir fry and come with a lot of vegetables. Chinese food is more like soy sauce, but I use more like curry, ginger, basil, lemongrass. So a lot of seasoning that come with it to make it more flavorful.
Well, everybody I know who's been there raves about your restaurant and about you and your personality. You're very warm, very friendly, and make it a little safe.
Well, I look at this way. People that come through my door is my family. Come to my house. So I feed them, I take care of them just like family. And everybody love coming back. Right, Francis?
Yes. I'm a big fan. And many years.
He's been coming here since her baby was so little.
And he's 21 now, so.
I know, right? We've been friends forever. And Joe, you also been here.
Oh, yes. Your food is fantastic.
Yes. And we had a full house tonight. And thanks for squeezing me in.
Thank you for coming. I'm going to be in town soon. I'm going to try to surprise Wilma because she would love your food. But let me say this. I felt very guilty about asking Dal to come on tonight because we're actually taping on Valentine's Day, which is a favorite day that people take people out to dinner. And we had decided that she wasn't going to come. She was going to send her son and her daughter-in-law. They were going to come instead. So I look for a call from Dal. Dal says, Joe, my son says, Mom, you got to go. This is a wonderful thing.
Exactly. Mom, I'm not from Thailand. You have to do this. So here I am.
So thank you so much for coming on. And I hope you had a crowded house tonight. And I hope that they don't miss you too much.
Not yet. Yeah, we have a full house. And thank you. Thank you again for, you know, have me in your show again.
Well, here's the surprise to me. We just had a COVID, and so many restaurants have closed. There's so many of our favorite places are not open anymore because people weren't coming out. How did you manage and maintain during COVID?
Well, the lunchtime I have to close because a lot of people work at home. So I can't afford it to open lunch anymore. So I only open for dinner only. And just like we're doing it now, podcast. People don't go to work. People work at home.
Yeah, one major thing in our culture, a lot of people are working from home now. I mean,
I do a lot of takeout. Takeout is great for me.
So you do have takeout now, which I'm keeping that in mind also. As a matter of fact, we're on Zoom tonight, and I'm in Maryland right now, and I've been able to keep my show on because of Zoom. Although I must say the studio is gorgeous. That studio is gorgeous, and it's really phenomenal. Dal, tell us about some differences between Thai culture and American culture. I get the impression that the group is very important in Thai culture, more important than the individual. Would you agree?
The Thai culture, it's a little bit more polite than American.
Uh-huh. Okay.
So it's just like the way we say hi, say hello or whatever. And just like national, like I'm a Buddhist.
Uh-huh.
But we kind of like different culture on like a, I'm a Buddhism, and I don't go to church and all that stuff, but I'm not sure. But pretty much the same. I'm kind of like American eyes now because I live here for so long. So I'm kind of like immune to it, and this is my home.
Well, we like to celebrate all cultures, all religions. And so we think that God speaks to all of us in different ways. We need to appreciate all of them. I'm almost out of time. I want to thank all of my guests. I want to thank Dal Fox, Francine Scoboria, Saoni Segura. I want to thank Rebecca Reppert. And I want to thank Charlise Bell, because all of you have been wonderful tonight. For my regular audience, we'll be on again the second. You'll see me now on the second Monday in March. We're going to be on in April. We'll probably do something with seniors. And I also want to thank all the people, especially Mr. John Freeman at BCTV, who make this possible. You're going to see how you can contact me if you have suggestions about future programs. But thank you all for joining us tonight. And again, let's celebrate women. We have had four wonderful women to really come on tonight and show us how women are really important in our lives. And we men have to recognize them, respect them, and give them all the power they deserve. Thanks, everybody. God bless. Good night.
Good night. Thank you, Joe.
Diversity, the wider vision on BCTV, is supported by Berks Community Action Program.